Hi there. I'm Micaela Kaplan, the ML Evangelist at HumanSignal, and this is In the Loop, the series where we help you stay in the loop with all things data science and AI. This week on In the Loop, we're going to talk about Krippendorff's Alpha, the final part in our agreement series. Let's get started. Krippendorff's Alpha, much like Cohen's or Fleiss's Kappa, is a dataset level metric that helps you understand how reliable your annotators are. The difference here is that Krippendorff's Alpha is far more flexible than either of the Kappa metrics we talked about last time. It can handle incomplete data, can compare an arbitrary number of raters, and can handle more than just simple classifications. The formula for Krippendorff's Alpha might seem familiar. It's the observed agreement minus the expected agreement over 1 minus the expected agreement. That's the same general formula as we used last time. Once again, the difference here will be how we compute each of those terms. We'll work through an example together. Let's say you have 4 raters rating 10 items. In last week's example, we asked raters to rate yes or no. This time, we'll ask raters to rate each item on a scale of 1 to 5. The first thing we need to do is prepare our data for calculation. Krippendorff's alpha only works when you have more than one rating on an item, so we need to remove any items that only have one rating. In this case, that's item 10. Now, we have a few variables that we'll need for our calculations. Little n, the number of items in the analysis, is 9. Little q, the number of rating categories, is 5. Now, we're going to need to calculate how many times each item received a given rating. This will look very similar to the table we made for Fleiss's Kappa last time, except instead of counting yeses and nos, we're counting scores 1 through 5. In the formula that we'll use in a minute, the item number is I, the rating category is K, and each of the values in the table are R sub I K, the number of times raters assigned an item I a score of K. We're also going to calculate the total number of ratings for each category, a simple sum, in the total column. This will be the value of R sub I. Finally, we'll average the total column, which gives us R bar, or the average number of raters who rated each item. The table is shown on the screen. Now, it's time to calculate the percent agreement, but first we need to decide what agreement means. This will provide the weight function that we'll use in the following steps. We could choose to interpret our ratings in a number of ways. We could choose to interpret them as nominal scores, which are scores with no hierarchy. A score of 1 is just as similar to a score of 2 as a score of 5. Two raters only agree if they pick exactly the same category, so the weight function is the same as the one that we looked at last time. If the two raters agree, they get a score of 1. Otherwise, they get a score of 0. Ordinal scores have a hierarchy. In this case, 5 is greater than 4, which is greater than 3, which is greater than 2, which is greater than 1. But there's no relative degree of difference. In this case, we could not make the claim that the difference between 4 and 5 is half the difference between 3 and 5. This is a pretty complicated weight function. Finally, interval scores have a fixed difference between categories. In this case, we could make the claim that 4 and 5 are half as far apart as 3 and 5. This uses a quadratic weight function. For simplicity's sake, we'll choose nominal scores for this example. Now, it's finally time to calculate our observed agreement. To get the observed agreement, we'll use the formula observed agreement equals 1 over n times the sum from I equals 1 to n of the observed agreement given I. Essentially, we're going to average the observed probabilities of each of the 9 items. What's the observed probability for each item? We'll use the formula shown on the screen. For a given item, we'll sum over every class the percent agreement. This score normalizes the weighted rating counts by the average number of ratings per item. Essentially, we do this by replacing R sub IK with the value in the table for each category K and item I and sum the results. For example, in our first item, we'll start with 0 times 0 minus 1 divided by 3.33 times 4 minus 1, and add the same formula with the number plugged in from the table as shown on the screen to get a total score of 0.601. We do this for all the rows in the table and average them to get 0.322 as our average observed agreement as shown on the screen. Finally, we can calculate our overall observed percent agreement by using the formula on the screen. Here, n times r bar is the total number of ratings. In this case, that's 30. We plug into the formula 0.322 times 1 minus 1 divided by 30 plus 1 over 30 equals 0.345. Now, we're ready to calculate our expected agreement, PE. We'll use the function on the screen. Basically, we'll sum over every category the weight of the category times pi sub k, the probability of the classification k, and pi sub L, the probability of a classification L. The classification agreement for each category is just the number of times that the category was picked across all items divided by the total number of ratings in the dataset, in this case 30. We can add up the values in the columns of the chart and divide to get the following numbers. We did some rounding here, so this number is slightly higher than 1, but we know that the percentages should add up to 1. Since we're using nominal agreement, the weight for agreement is 0 unless k and l are an exact match. So we can just sum the squares of pi sub k, since pi sub k and pi sub l will be the same. If we do that, we get 0.22 as our expected agreement. We're finally ready to calculate alpha. Let's plug into the formula. 0.345 minus 0.22 divided by 1 minus 0.22 gives us an alpha of 0.16. Krippendorff's alpha ranges from negative 1 to 1, with 0 being the random chance value. A negative score indicates that the raters disagree systematically. In other words, they probably are looking for different things or use the same facts in a different way. A score of 0.16 indicates fairly low agreement. It's better than chance, for sure, but there's a long way to go in terms of training your annotators. That was a lot. The calculations for Krippendorff's alpha are complicated, but the good news is that there are many packages available to you to help you do this in code, as well as some online calculators that work well. It's important to understand the math behind the function so that you can choose the right agreement for the task at hand. What do you want to see in a future in the loop? Let us know in the comments. That's all for this week. Thanks for staying in the loop. Want even more in the loop? Check out our other videos. Don't forget to like and subscribe to stay in the loop.